Up and down the dusty autumn, panic horsemen spurred, till all the border shuddered at the word of how that terror threatened every trail. They found him in the camp of Spotted Tail, a lonely figure with a face of care. I am afraid of what might happen there, he said. So many listen when I say, and look. I will not run away. I want my people here. You have my guns. But half a world away, the mighty ones had spoken words like bullets in the dark that wreak the rage of blindness on a mark they cannot know. Then spoke the one who led the soldiers, not a hair upon your head shall suffer any harm if you will go to Robinson for just a day or so and have a parley with the soldier chief. He spoke believing, and he won belief. So Crazy Horse went riding down the west, and neither he nor any trooper guessed what doom now made a rutted wagon road the highway to a happier abode, where all the dead are splendidly alive, and summer lingers, and the bison thrive forever.
If the better hope be true, there was a gate of glory yawning through the sunset as the little cavalcade approached the fort. The populous parade, the straining hush that somehow wasn't peace, the bristling troops drawn up as for a battle, the Indian police. What was wrong? What made them hustle Crazy Horse along amid the gleaming bayonets and eyes? There swept a look of quizzical surprise across his face. He struggled with the guard. Their grips were steel. Their eyes were cold and hard like bayonets. There was a door flung wide. The soldier chief would talk with him inside, and all be well at last. The stifling, dim interior flung terror over him. He blinked about and saw the iron bars. Oh, nevermore to neighbor with the stars or know the simple goodness of the sun. Did some swift vision of a doom begun reveal the monstrous purpose of a lie? The desert island and the alien sky, the long and lonely ebbing of a life?
The glimmer of a whipped out butcher knife dismayed the shrinking squad, and once again men saw a face that many better men had died to see. Brown arms that once were kind, a comrade's arms, swept round him from behind, went crimson with a gash and dropped aside. Don't touch me, I am Crazy Horse, he cried, and leaping doorward, charged upon the world to meet the end. A frightened soldier hurled his weight behind a jabbing belly thrust, and Crazy Horse plunged headlong in the dust, a writhing heap.
The momentary din of struggle ceased. The people crowding in went ominously silent for a space, and one could hear men breathing round the place where lay the mighty. Now he strove to rise, the wide blind stare of anguish in his eyes, and someone shouted, "Kill that devil, quick!" A throaty murmur and a running click of gunlocks woke among the crowding Sioux, and many a soldier whitened. Well they knew what pent-up hate the moment might release, to drop upon the bungled farce of peace a bloody curtain.
One began to talk. His tongue was drunken and his face was chalk. But when a half-breed shouted what he spoke, the crowd believed, so few had seen the stroke. Nor was there any bleeding of the wound. It seemed the chief had fallen sick and swooned. Perhaps a little rest would make him strong. And silently they watched him borne along, a sagging bundle, dear and mighty yet, though from the sharp face beaded with the sweat of agony, already peered the ghost.
They laid him in an office of the post, and soldiers forming in a hollow square held back the people. Silence deepened there. A while it seemed the man was dead, he lay so still. The West no longer bled. Among the crowd, the dusk began to creep. Then, as startled out of sleep by some old dream-remembered night alarm, he strove to shout, half rose upon an arm, and glared about him in the lamp-lit place. The flare across the ashes of his face went out. He spoke, and leaning where he lay, men strained to gather what he strove to say. So hard the panting labor of his words. I had my village and my pony herds out yonder on the Powder, where the land was all our own. I only wanted to be let alone. I did not want to fight. Gray Fox sent his soldiers. We were poorer when they went. Our babies died, for it was cold and many lodges burned. We hoped again and turned our faces westward. It was the same out yonder on the Rosebud. Gray Fox came. The dust his soldiers made was high and long. I fought him and I whipped him. Was it wrong to drive him back? That country was our own. We only wanted to be let alone. I did not want to see my people die. They say I murdered Longhair, and they lie. His soldiers came to kill us, and they died. He choked and shivered, staring hungry-eyed as if to make the most of little light. Then, like a child that feels the clutching night and cries the wilder, deeming it in vain, he raised a voice made lyrical with pain and terror of the thing about to be. I want to see you, Father, come to me. I want to see you, Mother. O'er and o'er his cry assailed the darkness at the door, but from the gloom beyond the hollow square of soldiers quavered voices of despair. We cannot come. They will not let us come.
But when at length the lyric voice was dumb and Crazy Horse was nothing but a name, there was a little withered woman came behind a bent old man. Their eyes were dim. They sat beside the boy and fondled him, remembering the little names he knew before the great dream took him. And he grew to be so mighty. And the woman pressed a hand that men had feared against her breast and swayed and sang a little sleepy song. Out yonder in the village all night long, there was a sound of mourning in the dark. And when the morning heard the meadowlark, the last great Sioux rode silently away. Before the pony drag on which he lay, an old man tottered, bowed above the bier, a little withered woman kept the rear, without a sound and nothing in her eyes. Who knows the crumbling summit where he lies alone among the badlands? Coyotes prowl about it, and the voices of the owl assume the day-long sorrow of the crows, these many grasses and these many snows.